Hello everyone, I'm Jack Somerset, and today I'm going to be talking to you about the power of sport to change perceptions, build positive images, and the transformation from disabled to superhuman. I've chosen this subject as for the last 18 months I've been developing my skills as a sports photographer and witnessed the highs and lows inherent in both amateur and professional sport. My growing interest in sports photography has coincided with 2012's fantastic summer of sport. I was lucky enough to be in the Olympic Stadium during Super Saturday and experience an overwhelming connection with 80,000 people cheering in harmony. It struck me that sport can be about much more than the final score. And after the Olympics, for the first time ever, I actually engaged with the Paralympics along with many others, found myself cheering as hard for the Paralympians as I had done for a few weeks earlier for Mo Farah and Jessica Ennis. And it made me wonder why this had happened at the Paralympics and not before. Can sport really change attitudes by projecting positive images that we can all connect with? And how did this happen in 2012? The London 2012 Paralympics reached a greater audience in this country than ever before, with the help of Channel 4's 500 plus hours of coverage. 11.2 million tuned in to watch the opening ceremony, and 7.2 million to watch the closing ceremony, blowing out expectations. It's safe to say the Olympics and the Paralympics have done wonders for our positive perceptions, about not just disability, but for race and gender too. All of that hasn't happened by accident though. Through a combination of media, press, imagery, and government initiative, we're one of the most accepting and inspiring countries to host the Olympic Games. Channel 4's trailer, The Superhumans, directed by Tom Tagholm, is a clear example of this. Trevor Beattie, co-founder of B&B Advertising, described it as the commercial of the year by a million miles, and insists it's helped to change prejudices. Let's go back to Sydney 2000 Olympics. Sydney is regarded as a huge turning point for the Paralympics. Before then, the Paralympics had only been held in four other countries since its inauguration in 1960, and often was held at different times to the Olympics themselves. Atlanta 96 was a disaster for Paralympians, and Sydney wanted to change that. Schools and communities were targeted in Australia years before the Games in an effort to raise awareness, and as a result, over a million spectators attended, double that of Atlanta. Around the time of Sydney Paralympics, there was a much greater awareness around disability that came mostly from the media. But did it really make a connection with the public? Dr. Simon Darcy, a professor of sports at Sydney's University of Technology and Business School, says the benefits were short-lived, and that as a result, Sydney missed opportunities to build long-term infrastructure for disabled people. Many athletes were able to board their trains near their venues, but couldn't get off somewhere else at the end of their trip. Beijing fell into a similar trap. For their 2008 Paralympic Games, attention turned to their 83 million disabled citizens. Access around the country was increased, and the Chinese public are now actively learning about the less abled. But some discrimination still remains. In China, it's mandatory that 1.5% of a business's staff must be disabled, which is widely ignored, and applications still commonly specify details like sex, age, and even physical attributes. So let's look back at us now, the London 2012 Olympics. So how did our perceptions improve? It boils down to several factors. one of which is media. When we think of disabilities within advertising, what comes to mind? Health awareness, insurance, charities. We're told to think about the livelihood of loved ones, plan for the unexpected, and give to those less fortunate than us. Pity is a strong emotion used within these advertisements to get the audience's attention and to think about the message presented to them. As a result, these feelings are carried through into everyday life and exercise regularly. Channel 4's Superhuman trailer is a clear example of really challenging that. With a thumping soundtrack, hardly you think, from the hip-hop group Public Enemy, which included lines like, "Thank you for letting us be ourselves," and "Live life like you just don't care," the finished product was a high-octane mashup of sweaty bodies, immeasurable sporting skill, stumps, prosthetics, and super slow-mos. This was a trailer which a serious amount of work went into, and for all the right reasons. According to director Tom Tagholm, the ad was shot over 16 days, and I quote, "shows the athletes the way they deserve to be seen." Tom wanted to absolutely embrace their stance, the ways they've adapted to their sport, and the ways they've used their bodies, so there was no tiptoeing around anything. Tom teamed up with photographers the Wade Brothers to create an ad campaign, which spanned many forms of media. They explained that the idea was to imagine a sense of place and sensation, and create images and videos that tell a cohesive story, whether for film or print. And I think you'll agree that these photos are supercharged with atmosphere, portraying these incredible athletes as something more than sportsmen and women, in keeping with Channel 4's exceptionally crafted message. Beautifully composed and brilliantly communicative, these are the images which have helped change the way disability is viewed in this country. Examples of this are Johnny Peacock alone, training on a wet track, or two silhouettes of Paralympic cyclists highlighting their injuries whilst conveying a sense of supremacy. It was these images which were used in the papers and on billboards. Kate Peters was one such other photographer who created a series entitled Olympic Bodies, commissioned by Kate Edwards at the Guardian Weekend magazine and photographed in numerous makeshift studios across the UK, from squash courts to gymnasiums and corridors. 32 athletes were photographed, filmed and interviewed over the course of 3 months. The Olympians project is a testament to the incredible bodies of the hopeful British athletes who pushed themselves to the limit with the aim of achieving success at 2012 Olympics. The project combined both Olympians like Sir Chris Hoy and Jessica Ennis and Paralympians like Richard Whitehead and David Weir. Both groups are portrayed exactly the same way and no contrasts are made between their physical differences. They all look equally powerful. The Paralympians project an additional, almost hybrid quality, a perfect adaptation between muscle and metal. Sarah Story, a Paralympic cyclist, said, "The level of competition at the Paralympics is just as fierce. The determination is the same. It's just the competitors have limbs missing or not working quite as well. After a while, you don't see the disabilities. Everyone is an athlete first." Press, newspapers, magazines, and online articles were a key factor to changing perceptions. While online editions of American newspapers found it necessary to explain that the Paralympics is an athlete event for physically challenged athletes, British newspapers were discussing the brilliance of their hometown athletic heroes without once having to mention that one was a dwarf, the other an amputee, or another a paraplegic. They were merely referred to as marathoners, swimmers, or sprinters, and included in the same sentences as Usain Bolt, Mo Farah, and Jessica Ennis. Paralympians themselves had a part to play in all this too. The press and media gave them a platform and they seized the opportunity to focus on their achievements rather than the challenges they had faced, also recognising the shifts in attitudes that occurred in London 2012. Athlete Oscar Pistorius said, "The UK has come a very long way. I compete here every year and I know people in the UK are far more educated when it comes to disabilities than many other countries in the world." Joshua George, a USA wheelchair racer, is quoted saying, "While America yet again struggles to get over what is different, embrace what is great, London has set the standard in hosting the Olympic and Paralympic Games. Having competed in Rio de Janeiro before, I'm optimistic that Brazil will be able to carry the torch further." Channel 4's advertising reimagining of the Paralympic Games could only do so much. It built our expectations as high as the Olympics, but also meant for a longer lasting impression, it was a necessity for our Paralympians to follow through. The 500 plus hours of coverage meant we were able to watch every athlete, every step of the way. And sure enough, once David Weir claimed his fourth gold crossing the marathon finish line, a total of 120 Paralympic medals had been won for GB, almost double that of GB's Olympic total. Before the Paralympics, many of us didn't recognise or know who any of our Paralympians were. But over the 2 weeks, we cheered with record-breaking decibel levels for all the athletes who won, took part, and even more so for those who finish several minutes behind their competitors. As a result, Great Britain has some of the most well-known and inspiring athletes. They are not seen as celebrities, but as heroes. However, is this any different to what happened in Sydney and Beijing? How can we tell if perceptions have really changed? Or is this just another transitory feel-good effect? One useful indicator of longer-term legacy is to see if there will be any more funding for disabled sports following the Paralympics. I approached Sport England for their perspective and they sent me information about their funding for various sports. Initial indications are good. Whilst government funding for all sports remains relatively flat, sports aimed specifically at disabled individuals like wheelchair basketball, wheelchair rugby will see an increase of funding up to 185% for the next 4 years. Initiatives set to specifically encourage all handicapped personalities to take part. We saw the Paralympics rise into equality after Sydney 2000 with fair coverage and attention. Over 1 million tickets were sold, but a large number of seats were still empty. Beijing improved on that, but it was London 2012 which embraced it with so much enthusiasm. A sellout 2.7 million tickets were sold, close to 1 million more than that of Beijing in 2008. So what did happen and why did it work? I see there are three factors that combine together. First, the Superhumans film arrived on our screens a week before the Olympics. It was the perfect setup to build expectations. It challenged prejudices and replaced them with positive emotions and anticipation. Second, the media, including photography and Paralympians themselves, all consistently reinforced this new positive and powerful image throughout the Games. And thirdly, and most importantly, the Paralympians achieved and surpassed all expectations. Ultimately, I suggest that sport can change perceptions, but the athletes have to deliver or it's an empty message. Due to the combination of media, positive image and performance, London 2012 will forever be known for the Paralympic superhuman.
People bear witness. Thank you for letting us be ourselves. So don't mind me if I repeat myself. These simple rhymes be good for your health. To keep them crime rhymes on the shelf. Live, love life like you just don't care. 5,000 leaders never scared. Rain and noise is the moment they feared. Get up, still a beautiful idea.